The Diagnosis by Alan Lightman. Copyright 2000 by Alan Lightman. This full-length reading was published by arrangement with Gelfman Schneider Literary Agents Incorporated, New York, and was produced in 2000 by Books on Tape Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. This book has 369 pages and is read by Scott Brick. Should you have any questions about this recording, please call the customer service number shown on the package for information or assistance. The following material appears on the dust jacket of the book. Alan Lightman's previous books include Einstein's Dreams, Good Benito, and Dance for Two. A professor of humanities and a lecturer in physics at MIT, he lives in Boston. Dedication. In memory of Jean Gerritsen Lightman, and for Jean, Elise, and Kara. On the subway. People must have been in a great hurry, for no one noticed anything wrong with Bill Chalmers as he dashed from his automobile one fine summer morning. Earnest and dressed in a blue cotton suit, he was immediately swept up by the mass of commuters also galloping from their cars toward the elevators and down to the trains of the Alewife station, a cavernous structure of concrete and crisscrossed steel struts, one end of the Red Line through Boston. At the ground floor, Chalmers presented his pass and rushed through the turnstile. He was halfway down the stairs to the platform when he heard the taut string of electronic beeps and the doors began sliding on train number one. A woman groaned. Another commuter, a tall, nervous man with squeaky shoes, lunged ahead and ran alongside the train, shouting and slapping his magazine against the red paneled doors. But the train was already in motion, its steel wheels scraping and squealing so fiercely that several people had to turn up their headsets. The tall man swiveled and shot Chalmers an accusing stare, as if his lack of sufficient speed through the turnstile had caused a half dozen people to miss their trains. What a jerk, Chalmers thought to himself and looked down at his watch. It was 8:22. 23 minutes to his stop, a 9-minute walk to his building, 2 minutes on the elevator, and he'd be sitting at his desk by 9 o'clock. Assuming the train on track 2 arrived and departed within 4 minutes, as it should. With some satisfaction, he reminded himself that unlike the ridiculously agitated man with a magazine, he had calculated his morning commute so that he could miss the first train and still arrive at the office on time. Abruptly, he began worrying that the train on track 2 might be late. Never had that happened when he'd missed train number 1, but it was certainly a possibility. Stroking his mustache, he continued down the stairs and looked again at his watch. He mustn't waste the 4 minutes. However, he slowed his descent to drop 50 cents into the cup of a homeless woman sprawled on the edge of the stairs. She looked disturbingly like his old piano teacher. "Thank you, kind sir," she said. "Please don't thank me," he answered, embarrassed. "I thank everyone who is more fortunate than me," she called to him as he hurried down to the platform. Waves of people flowed around him, jostling and crushing from all sides, shoving each other to gain an advantage for the next arriving train. Gulped down in seconds were muffins and rolls, hard-boiled eggs, bananas, coffee, and crackers. Some commuters tried to unfold newspapers in the cramped space but gave up and contented themselves with staring at the digital sign on the kiosk, where bits of news in the correct time scrolled by in bright glowing dots. The dozens of upturned faces were waxy and yellow beneath the underground fluorescent bulbs. Even in that pale yellow light, if any of those waiting had looked carefully into Chalmers' eyes, they might have observed a faint petrifaction, a solidification, some sign that all was not well. But they did not, occupied with their own busy schedules and the marching dots on the sign. Chalmers himself felt perfectly fit, aside from the normal stresses and aches of a man just past 40, arguably overweight but by no means fat. He glanced at his watch, 8:23, and forged a path to the kiosk. Above his head, the digital sign flickered and hummed, and something clattered repeatedly against the high concrete ceiling, and the air sagged with the burnt smell of hot brake fluid. Several radios blared, jumbling their throbbing bass notes in competing rhythms. Huddled against the kiosk as if battling a strong wind, a woman in a smart linen suit was delivering instructions into a cellular telephone. Chalmers couldn't help noticing that her phone was a new model, considerably smaller and sleeker than his. He took out his own phone from his briefcase. As he began dialing, he found that he was still shaken by the poor woman on the stairs. Her misery had cast a gloom over him, which he tried to forget by pushing the tiny buttons as fast as he could. First, he called Jenkins to make sure that the proper documents would be ready for his 9:15 meeting. All was in order. He hung up and stood on his toes, peering down the dark tunnel of track 2. Over the track, hundreds of glowing red neon tubes dangled down from the ceiling, one of them broken and blinking like a Christmas tree light. His telephone rang. Two men reached inside their briefcases, thinking it theirs. "Mr. Chalmers, this is Robert again. You didn't tell me if you wanted the Lehman file for the meeting."
"No. Thank you, Robert."
"Just checking to make sure everything is in order, Mr. Chalmers. We're set for TEM at 10:30.
That Jenkins was an excellent young man, Chalmers said to himself. He would remember to compliment him when he arrived at the office. People didn't compliment each other nearly enough. Everyone was too quick to criticize.
Chalmers looked at his watch and dialed his voicemail. As the connection was being relayed through space or wherever, who knew exactly where cellular transmissions were at any one instant, he twisted his neck and gazed up at the digital sign. 8:24. Introducing a new feature of Providential Services, Providential Online. Get stock quotations on your pager minute by minute. Think of Providential Online as work wherever, whenever. PO at provins.com. 8:24. Chalmers fumbled with a pencil and hurriedly copied down the email address before it fled from the screen, while a feminine voice crooned from his telephone receiver, "The Plymouth voicemail system will be disabled for 12 hours, beginning at midnight on June 26th, while Telecom performs an upgrade of the system. At Telecom, progress is our business. You have 3 messages." Which must have arrived in the previous 20 minutes since Chalmers last checked his voicemail. A dog barked. What were dogs doing down here, he wondered. People should be more considerate. Last week he had come within inches of stepping in dog poop. He retrieved his first message. "Jasper Allswanger calling. I need to talk. Hold it a moment, please. Sorry, that was call waiting. I need to talk to you as soon as possible. You've got my number." Someone was shouting Chalmers' name over the roiling of voices and music and dogs. He removed his ear from the receiver and went up on his toes. 20 feet away, he spotted the shouter, now waving and grinning. "Yes," Chalmers answered, trying to make out the man's head in the ocean of pale, fluorescent faces. Gradually, he recognized the sunken eyes of Tim Cotter, his neighbor across the street. He didn't know Cotter very well. Cotter worked in a small bank somewhere downtown and came home late every night to the loud reprisals of his wife. Chalmers waved back good-naturedly and started to retrieve his second message. Someone elbowed him, shoving the phone into the side of his head. The neighbor continued waving and shouting, "Bill! Bill!" with a definite note of urgency, as if there was something he needed to tell him that moment. "What?" Chalmers shouted back, still standing on his toes. His neighbor didn't seem to hear him, then removed one of his earphones and yelled, "What did you say?" "I thought you wanted to tell me something," Chalmers shouted back, realizing at once that he had used far too many words under the circumstances. "Lower your voice," yelled a cheeky college boy standing next to him. "You're destroying my eardrums." The student made a face and slapped his hands over his ears. Chalmers glanced at his watch. He had only 2 minutes or less to retrieve his messages. With a sigh, he began working his way through the concrete thick crowd toward his neighbor. Cotter shouted something else, which Chalmers didn't hear, and refastened his headphones. Now Chalmers could see that his neighbor was sitting on some kind of fancy foldable chair, like a beach chair or a country lawn chair.
He made a mental note that he should get one for himself. "Guess what I'm doing," said Carter, keeping one of the earphones pressed against his ear so that he could listen and talk at the same time. His fingers tapped on his briefcase. "I don't know. What are you doing?" "I'm reading," said Carter, grinning broadly. He paused to let the announcement sink in. "Books on tape. The Bridges of Madison County." Chalmers made a thumbs-up sign. For the first time, he realized how much he disliked Carter. In 100 little ways, Carter always tried to make him feel like a slacker. Carter was just envious of anyone seriously engaged in their profession. It was Carter who was the slacker. The dog was barking again, and Chalmers began coughing, having inhaled an invisible cloud of the burnt brake fluid air. In addition, the morning's usual indigestion had just slammed into his stomach. "Nice to talk to you," said Carter. "I haven't seen you since."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.